In the meantime, I relinquish all responsibility for what happens over the next hour and a half. It belongs to Mr. Gerry Anderson.
Thank you, John. Good morning. Welcome from Henman Hill.
BBC Radio Foyle.
And BBC Radio Ulster.
With Gerry Anderson.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you, John Bennett in Belfast. Thank you, Susan McReynolds, up here on BBC Radio Foyle. It's now 29 minutes to 11 o'clock. It's seldom I give you a time check, which goes to show you how much I love you. If you want to contact this programme, the number is 08459-555-678. I'll repeat that for the benefit of those who are not at themselves, which indeed includes me, I have to say. 08459-555-678. If you want to join us via email, there's no reason at all why you can't. It's jerry.anderson@bbc.co.uk. Before I go any further, let me congratulate Newry on attaining city status yesterday. From now on, Newry is now a city. Who knows? Newry may yet reach the heady heights we've reached here in Stoke City, whereby the citizens risk their lives if they walk through the city centre after midnight. You've all that to look forward to. Here's Christy Moore.
There was a woman and she lived in her own, slaved in her own, skinned in her own. She had two little boys, two little girls. She lived all alone with her husband. He was a hunk of a man, a chunk of a man, a drunk of a man, a hunk of a drunken skunk of a man. Such a boozy, bruising bully of a husband. When he came home drunk at night, he trashed her black and trashed her white, trashed her to within an inch of her life, and snored all night like a finger drunken husband. One night she gathered her tears all round her shame, covered up the bruise and cried with the pain. You'll not do that ever again. I'll not live anymore with a drunk of a husband. And that night as he lay drunk in bed, the strangest thought came to her head. She took the needle and the thread and went straight into her sleeping husband. She started with a girlish thrill, a woman's eye, a seamstress skill. She bit and tucked with an iron will as she stitched all round her sleeping husband. The top sheet, the bottom sheet too, the blanket stitched, the mattress through. She bit and tucked the whole night through, waiting for the dawn and her husband. With a pain in his head, he found that he could not move in bed. Sweet God in heaven, if I lost me legs. She just sat and smiled at her husband. In her hand she held a frying pan, with a flutter in her heart she flew at him. He could not move, he cried, God damn, don't you swear at me, you dirty husband. She beat him black, she beat him blue, with the frying pan and the colander too, with the rolling pin, a stroke or two. Such a battered and repenting husband. If you ever come home drunk again, I'll stitch you up and sew you in. Then I'll pack my bags and I'll be gone. I'll not live anymore but a drunk of a husband. Isn't it true what a wife can do with the needle thread and the stitcher too? He is wiped his slate and his boozing's through. She don't live anymore but a drunken husband.
That's Christy Moore, of course. That's a song called Stitch in Time. That was especially for, let me see, we request here. It's very hot in here.
For interrupting.
It's very hot in here.
It's very hot. I had the door open.
It's a plague ward.
No. There's a man standing with his coat and hat on. He's got a bus to catch.
How do you know that?
He told me.
He's got his coat. He told you he's got his coat and hat on.
And he's trying to catch a bus.
Where did he tell you that?
Just there now, so he's there.
Okay. Hello, good morning.
Must have caught the bus. Is he there?
No, he's not there unless he's standing going, ooh.
We'll try it again.
Hello?
Say hello, Eddie.
Hello, Eddie.
No, he must be away then.
Yeah,
that,
that's a good start.
Well, you see, you were that long.
No, I wasn't that long at all. I was in the middle of doing a request.
I
and you interrupted me for a man who wasn't there wearing a hat and coat going, whoo! Right, this is getting ridiculous already, and it's only 25 to 11.
Well, turn me off.
I've tried. I will turn you off with the greatest of pleasure, may I say. I'll just turn you off now. Look, I lost the request now. Oh, yeah, that was a special request for Margaret Wallace, who was 60 last Monday. I promised to play a little request for her that was from the Stevenson and Hannah families. And also want to say a special hello to Speedy Hamilton. Many people may remember Speedy. He was a lead singer in the Platterman Show Band, a wonderful, wonderful singer. And he's in hospital. He's not too well, but he's in good form. So his friend Mick Collins sends me an email saying he's grand, and we could play something for him, and I will play something for him because he's a dear friend and a nice guy, and I hope he's going to be out of hospital soon, which I hope he will be. I understand he will be. And Anne McGrath writes to me and she says, whilst you were away recently, a song was played on your show.
Try him now. Try him now. Please. Just try him. He's got his keys in his hand now.
You're interrupting me something
serious
today.
He's got his keys in his hand.
It's too hot in here for this. Hello, good morning.
Hello.
Hello, good morning, sir.
Good morning, Mr.
I believe you have a hat
Anderson.
Yes, uh-huh. I believe you have a hat and coat on.
Well, I'm ready to... I'm going to turn this radio down now. I'm ready to... There you are, my glasses and all. I'm
Excuse a second, is he sober?
No, that's the man who does the impersonations.
Well, he's doing a impersonation of a drunk man. Good morning. Are you sober, sir?
I am.
All right, then. Just carry on, because...
To tell a lie, I have a three in me, man.
He does what?
He does...
drinks in me.
Eddie does Mr. Magoo, and he does Jimmy Cagney.
He
and
says
he
has three drinks in him.
He's telling lies.
He's telling the truth, because it's something like
no,
that.
No, he's winding up to a character.
Are you winding up to a character, Eddie?
Pardon?
Are you winding up to a character? Are you pretending
am I waiting up to be one character?
Or three, or four, or five characters? He's full.
He's not.
He is.
He's driving a bus.
Because I drove a bus too one time full. And
no, you uh-huh. didn't.
Are you sober, sir?
Well,
yes or no?
Well, put it this way, Jerry. I'm looking forward to this Brazilian match today.
There you are, you see.
He's full as a pole.
He's not.
I don't mind if he's full. I just want to know if he's full. You know, so well, I'm warned. I'm ready for him.
No, he's not. No,
he's full as a pole.
Jerry, who do you fancy in this semi-final now? Germany 3? Who would you fancy now at the second semi-final? Who would you think?
Brazil and Turkey today, you say?
Uh-huh.
I have to put my hand in my heart and say that I can see no reason why Brazil will not proceed to the final and indeed win the trophy.
Well, that's my point of view from the start of the World Cup was Brazil, they will do it.
I'm very glad to hear that, and I'm gratified.
Well, I always said Brazil would do it.
I'm sure you did. I mean, you have any
that's my point of view, but everybody has a different point of view.
I've noticed that throughout life. Everyone has a different point of view.
Mm-hmm. When your point of view would be different from my point of view.
That's one of the things that makes us unique, and that's why uh-huh. Ulster
we can't be all bin men. We can't be all singers. We can't be all... besties, George besties and things like that. Come on.
No, we can't all be besties, no.
We can't all be George Best. We can't all be Ronaldo's. We can't be all... you know what I mean?
You're drinking very early today. May I ask you that? So I hope it's not an insult to you. What have you
had? No. How do you know I have a drink on me?
I can tell. Maybe not. Maybe it's just your personality.
That's just my personality.
Okay,
Jerry.
I'm sorry.
I'm the same. If I had one drink or 10 drinks, I'd be just the same.
Have you had any drink today?
Is that a personal question?
I'm afraid it is. It'll make no difference. It doesn't mean I'm going to turn you off if you say yes.
Yeah.
I just want to know from an academic point of view. You've had one drink.
Two.
That's
three.
Three.
You're not ringing up the clock now, aren't you, Jay?
What have you?
1, 2 o'clock, 3 o'clock.
What have you had today? Come on.
Pardon?
What have you had to drink today? Come on.
Well, had my breakfast.
Yes.
Yes.
Yes. What did you have for breakfast?
Did I have for breakfast? Yes. A late one.
What did you have? You have a piece of toast?
Yes. Boiled egg.
Boiled egg and then a large vodka.
No, I don't drink spurs, yeah.
All right, then. Okay, let's get away from that. It's your personal business.
Yes. And what did you have for breakfast, may I ask?
A large brandy and a Pernod. I had a banana.
That's early morning breakfast.
I had a bowl.
What time have you had your time for your breakfast?
I'll tell you exactly what I had today. It's interesting stuff, isn't it, Mr. Clark?
One oat.
I'll tell you what I had today. I got up today and I had a little, you know, a little bottle of Actimel. Do you know what Actimel is?
No.
The greatest stuff ever, the orange stuff. It cleanses your inside. I had a little bottle of Actimel. And then
it's like liver salt.
No, it's not. It's like, I don't know what it is. It's supposed to be good for you. I drink it anyway. I like it every morning. Mm-hmm. And then I had a banana whilst I was listening to BBC Radio Foyle.
Uh-huh.
And then I had a bowl of Common Sense, which are raisins.
A bowl of Common Sense.
Which is wheat flakes, raisin and apple. And then I had nothing else. And then I shaved and took the dog out for a walk. Then I shaved the dog when I came back in. Then he took me out for a walk. And then I went, I'll tell you what, here's the most amazing thing. Then on my way home, I called into the bakery. On my way here, I hesitate to call it work. On my way here, I called into the bakery and I bought two freshly baked cream buns.
Yes.
Cream cookies. Mm-hmm. And I went up and I made a cup of tea in the kitchen, radio foil, and I had those. So I have two cream buns, an Actimel, a bowl of cornflakes and raisins and apples, and a banana in me.
What did you give the dog?
I gave the dog a small, twisted mass of beef. And it was very happy to get it. I'm not quite sure where we're going with this. But I refuse to ask you again if you've drink taken, because it's none of my business. But it just seems to me that you're...
I blame it on the World Cup, Jerry.
For what?
Well, for drinking.
I know, there's a lot of men... A drink to...
Man, yes. Have you asked a lady?
Well, you see, women...
Have you asked a lady, can you tell me a score? Maybe you're out during the World Cup there, you know, the early stages of the World Cup.
Excuse me a second. Just a moment.
I don't know. I said, I'm only leaving the house, sir. I'm only out 10 minutes and there was no score, but you know.
Just a second. Sean, what's going on?
Yes?
What's going on here? What's going on here?
I don't know.
What does he want?
He told me...
Jay, I'm going to miss a bus.
He's told me...
What did he say he wanted?
He phoned up to say that he was standing in his hall with his coat and hat on and he was trying to catch a bus.
He didn't say that.
Jay, all of that.
Karen's on two.
He's away now.
Yeah, but Karen's on two.
He didn't want anything. What did he want?
He says, can I have a quick word with Jerry? I'm standing here with my coat and hat on, and there's something I want to say to him, and he wouldn't tell me what it was.
But he didn't tell me either.
He says, quick, before the bus comes. So that's why I interrupted you. I thought he had something to say before the bus came.
He had nothing to say.
But you never asked him.
I asked him everything. He wouldn't tell me anything. But what did he want?
I don't know. That was over to Europe. Carol wants you in too.
I've got a request here. Would you please wish my daughter, Ruth Linus, and all her pals in year 7, the teachers, especially Miss Linus, at Carr's Glen Primary School, a farewell, and wish them luck. See how easily I can read a request when the chips are down. Hello, good morning. I hope you want something.
Hello, Jerry.
Yes, I hope you're a little bit more lucid than the last man.
Oh, definitely.
Not to imply that you're a man.
That would be easy anyhow.
I think that man had drink taken. I really do. I know the signs. I've been around drunk men for all my life.
Have you seen it?
I'm not low. Will you leave me alone?
You seem to be low.
Leave me alone, will you? I'm talking to a woman. Just go away for a moment, please. It's not too much.
You seem a wee bit low.
You've interrupted me 4 times already, and it's not 10:45 yet. Hello, good morning. I seem to be a bit low. Can you hear me okay?
Good morning. I can hear you fine.
According to my levels, I'm high as a kite.
Well, that's okay.
Well, don't be throwing your oar in here when it's not necessary. Hello, good morning. Sorry.
You can worry when someone goes to tie a piece of string onto you now and tries to make you fly.
There's no need for that.
Okay.
What can we do for you today?
I want to thank you.
What for?
I came on your show some time ago. I had puppies looking for homes.
Yes.
And I had 5 puppies and then I had 4.
Oh, I remember you.
Do you remember it?
I do indeed.
Well, I have to say that I just really wanted to come on today to thank the people that came for the puppies.
Did you get all the puppies
off? They were fantastic people. Oh, absolutely, great. And the puppies, all 9, got beautiful homes.
Oh, that's great.
So I thought, if that's indicative of the people on your show, you have a fantastic show.
Well, thank you very much indeed. Nice to know that nice people came along and took your puppies.
They were absolutely fantastic. If I had to went out and pick them, I couldn't have picked better people. They were absolutely fantastic. And I'd just like to thank Herbie and Francis for Tanya.
Yeah.
The one went to Portaferry, the Reeds. Francis's niece, who rang me up, and I got some gifts, and some of them were, I should have been giving them gifts for having the puppies.
Yeah, yeah.
But I just had to come on and thank them because they were absolutely fabulous.
Oh, that's great. Oh, it's nice of you to do that. It's nice to know that the little puppies are looked after.
Yeah, well, that was the main thing as well. You know, yeah. People said how much do you want for them? I said nothing, as long as they have a good home.
Yeah.
But the response was absolutely fantastic.
Oh, that's good.
And the homes were fantastic. So I thought, I wanted to wait until you came back. You were off for a while.
That's right, yeah.
And I said, well, since you did a good job yourself in putting it on the air, I thought, well, I have to thank you as well.
Okay, well, that's, you know, that's encouraging for people who may be in a similar dilemma.
Yes.
Who have a lot of pups and, you know, don't want to put them in the dog's home because they only keep them for a certain amount of time and then they...
I know that. Know. Well, that was the theory, but when it came down to it, you just can't do it.
No, you can't do it. No, you can't say, go in there,
impossible.
Lads. If anybody picks you up before 7 days, you're all right, but if not, forget about it. Yeah, you know.
I know.
Good night, Irene.
Exactly, and I've ended up with enough dogs myself because I can't have them put down.
No.
But the people that came for the dogs, they were absolutely fantastic, and I just wanted to thank them.
Okay, then. Well,
and
thank
yourself.
You very much. Thank you very much indeed.
That's no problem at
okay.
all.
Okay. All right, love. Thank you.
Fantastic show.
Bye.
Bye,
thank
Jerry.
You very much. Bye. Bye. You see?
Why he won't play Christy Hennessy? I'll ask him now, then. Okay, right, it's Mr. Kelly and a skillin. Right, okay, I'll mention this to him now. Okay, thank you now. Bye. But that was a Mr. Kelly from Inniskillen. Wants to know why you won't play Christy Hennessy.
Because there's no reason.
You played Christy Hennessy a lot.
Yeah.
Remember there was a time you played, what was the song? Sheila Gordon or Sheila Doherty? Sheila.
No, Sheila Doherty's a girl you used to go with years ago.
Sheila Brown, Sheila.
Oh, will you stop? The reason I'm not playing Christy Hennessy is because I don't have anything by Christy Hennessy at the moment.
But what was the song you played all the time?
I don't know.
You do know?
I don't know,
You were the first man to play it.
I was never the first... I was the first man to play it, whatever it was.
Yeah, you like that, don't you? It was the song where the girl kills her lover.
Really?
Sheila song.
Don't torture yourself. Let's just move on.
Ida's
okay?
on one.
Ida's on one. Let's move on. Hello, Ida.
Hello.
Yes, hello.
Hello. I believe you had a call yesterday looking for wedding cars, green wedding cars.
Not necessarily. This lady was walking through Belfast one day and she intends to be betrothed to her groom in the near future. And she saw two particular cars which were coloured the same and they were kind of an apricot green and another colour. They were two-toned wedding cars.
No, ours are solid green.
Solid green?
Yes, yes. It's a Rolls Royce and a Daimler limousine to match.
And the two of them are the same colour?
The two are the same colour. Now, I don't know of any other cars that are green in Northern Ireland.
Yeah, right.
As a matching pair.
Mm-hmm. Well, maybe she would consider that.
Uh-huh. Or
maybe, indeed, yours are the cars she's thinking of.
Well, it could very well be, you know, because sometimes in Belfast, say at the City Hall, and the flash of the City Hall could make it look a different colour.
How do you mean?
Do you know when a car's going past the building?
Yes.
Well, it has highly glaze on it. So therefore, the reflection of... I'm only referring to the City Hall as being in the sandstone. And the reflection of it could give it an appearance to be a two-tone.
That's quite an academic explanation, that. I'd never thought of that. A trick of the light.
A trick of the light, uh-huh.
Maybe your car...
But they are a matching pair. And they are one. The leading car is a Rolls Royce. It's a Silver Dawn. It's 1951, so it's quite a unique little shape.
Uh-huh.
And then the other car is a Daimler limo to match.
So they're not exactly the same cars, but they're the same.
They're identical colours.
Okay, right. Well, I would bet you. You know, you're probably right. That's probably just a trick of the light.
Uh-huh.
Because I can't imagine two-toned wedding cars for some reason.
Uh-huh.
It would be garish. Maybe perhaps you're the cars you're looking for. I'll tell you what.
Well, she's welcome to have a look. She's under no obligation whatsoever.
Oh, I'm sure she will.
Uh-huh.
You leave your number, and if she's listening, or indeed we'll look her number up yesterday and we'll give her a ring and tell her that you've got two cars that may be the one she's looking for.
That'll do, lovely.
Okay. And you do many weddings, do you?
Yes, yes, we do. We write quite frequently.
Does anybody ever book in the back?
Oh, no, we haven't had anything like that. No, Jerry, definitely not.
Well, your difference is that it's different from that of the taxi drivers of the city, then.
That's correct.
But do you know, anybody ever faint in the back? You know, the bride, groom, you know, never? Do you ever have any trouble? Of course, you're probably not out. You're not out yourself.
Oh,
are
I
you?
Drive myself, of course I do.
Do you?
I drive as many brides as my husband does.
Well, I'll tell you, you must have seen.
Actually, we go out as a pair. Noel and myself both go out and drive.
Uh-huh. You must have some stories to tell. I don't want to breach any confidences, but you must see some strange things.
Well, yes, yes, indeed. I remember one bride at Pickerley.
Yeah.
And that was in Balnahinch. And I arrived in the yard, and just as the bride came out of the house, the dog was on a chain, and it just came alongside me, and it filled my shoe with water.
Really? It had a little bucket.
Indeed.
It had a little bucket with it, had it?
No, my shoe, no.
I know what you mean, yes.
I just lifted his leg alongside my leg, you know.
Well, they're not supposed to do that until after they're married. So, I bet you meet many nervous brides and nervous grooms. Are they usually okay?
No, they're generally quite content.
Yeah.
Nervous mums, yes.
Yeah. Do you get any battle axes, any old mothers given out or at the last minute?
Oh, that would be disclosing a few things, wouldn't it?
No, I wouldn't like you to say that. But I'm sure you have the odd adventure then, I imagine.
Oh, very much so.
All right then, okay.
And I love doing it too.
Okay.
Uh-huh.
All right then. So is that what you do full time, is it?
Well, just, you know, it's generally Thursdays, Fridays and Saturdays here that runs the weddings. You know, we do the, you know, we get the odd Monday and Tuesday and Wednesday, but it's generally Thursday, Friday and Saturday.
Yeah, okay.
Uh-huh. And the Silver Lady wedding cars.
Okay, well, Silver Lady?
Uh-huh, Silver Lady.
Okay, where are
it's
you...
It's nothing to do with my hair now.
No, that's okay, I never suggested that. Now, where do you operate out of?
Kalinchi. Uh-huh, Skettrick Island, Kalinchi.
Skettrick Island?
Uh-huh.
Oh, that's a nice place. Oh, that's a lovely place.
It is a lovely place, it is indeed.
Oh, I was down there a couple of times, it's really beautiful down
there. Oh, were you down with Daft Eddie's?
I think I did. That's a pub, isn't it? That's a pub, isn't it?
Uh-huh.
I think I remember that.
I shouldn't be advertising. Sure shouldn't.
No. That's quite all right. Why don't you give us your number?
It's Kalinchi, which is... Well, it's 028...
Yeah.
97...
Yeah.
541-662.
Okay, anyone looking for a matching set of Daimlers and whatever it is?
Rolls Royce. It's a Rolls Royce and a Daimler. We also have a blue set as well.
A blue set?
Uh-huh. A Rolls Royce and Daimler also.
My God.
It's 1963 Cloud 3. So, you know, it's not an ordinary Rolls. They're quite unique.
Mm-hmm.
And then they're matching Daimler limos.
Okay, that's great. Anyone who wants to contact you, and especially the lady who was phoning up the other day looking to find out...
Yes, and anybody's very welcome to have a look at them. And you're very welcome yourself, Jerry.
No, I think my marriage days...
Oh, no, I don't even mean for that. You're very welcome to have a look at them if you'd like.
I could bring somebody down and pretend I'm getting married.
No, this is it. You could indeed.
You could drive me to the Isle of Man. All right, then. Thanks
over
very
the water.
Much. Yeah, thanks very much, love.
Okay.
Bye.
And thanks, Jerry.
Okay, bye.
All the very best.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Bye. What kind of car collected you at your wedding?
Uh-huh. I don't know. It was a black car. That's all I know.
Hearse.
There's a man wants to pull you up.
Right. Where is he? Oh, two. Okay, good morning, sir.
Good morning, Mr. Anderson.
I believe you have a beef of some kind.
I do.
What
you
is
were
it?
You were criticising charities yesterday.
Charities?
Charities for the money they spent on administration.
I was not. I wasn't criticising them. I was defending charities. A man rang up. A lady rang up and objected to the amount of the percentage of money that given to charity that's given for administration. I explained to her that if you have a charity that's doing its job, they have to employ professional people.
Well,
and they have to pay them. So it's a given thing that a certain proportion of the pound that you pay for charity goes on administration.
Well, I can give you... I can quote a couple of facts on it anyway.
Yes.
Trucker, for instance.
Trucker, yes.
A well-known charity to everyone.
Indeed.
4% for administration fees.
That's all right.
And 5% for advertising.
Yes, very important.
And delivery charges to Africa and all over the world.
Yeah, freight charges, that kind of thing.
Uh-huh.
Yes, okay.
Which brings it to a grand total of 91% of the money going to exactly where it has to go to.
Well, I think if all the charges can reach that figure, they can regard themselves as a success.
Well, that is factual.
Okay. All right, then. That's trucker.
I have been told this morning a very well-known countryman of yours, politician.
Yes.
Who has been known to donate money recently to different charities, donated a check for $30,000 yesterday to the hospice.
That'll be John Hume.
Very man.
Yeah, he's very good at that kind of thing. He's very good with his money.
Some of our politicians are very poor at it too.
He gave away all his Nobel Prize money.
Yes, but this is personal money.
Yeah, the other man didn't seem to bother.
This is personal money.
I know. This is money he got from the Gandhi Prize. Was that that?
No, this is personal money.
Are you serious?
His own personal check.
I thought that was money he won from the Gandhi Peace
Prize. No, that is already, he's already given that away.
As well?
Yes.
Oh, my God. Well, congratulations to him.
So you might think of doing something like up your BBC funding yourself.
Well, let me put it this way. The money I'm paid by the BBC just barely keeps me away from the bailiff. There's very little
don't
left.
Don't worry about the bailiff. Not as bad as he used to be.
I don't want to see that bowler hat coming up the street. I've seen it before.
Have you?
Oh, yes.
I don't know.
Well, thank you for filling this. Do you work for Trucker or yourself?
I don't work for them at all, but I phoned yesterday to find out. I knew it was roughly that sort of funding, mm-hmm. that sort of spending.
Yeah.
And I phoned yesterday and checked it out so if I could put things right this morning for some people that if they thought all their money was going, if they thought they were given £1 and there was 90 pence of it going on the ministry, would say, well, that's not worthwhile.
Well, 9 or 10% is fairly acceptable as far as I'm concerned.
Yes.
All right, then. Well, thank you very much, sir.
And you were talking about limos there. Those matching limos actually are on the Ravenhill Road.
Oh, the ones you're talking, the two-toned?
The two-toned ones.
All right, then. Ravenhill Road. Okay.
Ravenhill Road.
All right, then. We'll pass that info on.
They sit opposite the park there. There's a fleet of about 20 of them.
Really? You don't know the company now?
I don't know, but that's where it is.
All right. Thank you very much. You're a helpful man. Thank you.
Okay.
Bye.
Bye.
Bye. There we are. Here's a lady who said, whilst you were away recently, a song was played in your show called Phone Me From Heaven. I'm unaware of the lady singing it. Well, her name is Mari Murray. I haven't played her for a long time. I think it's time.
Where we can be discreet.
That's Marty Murray. Tom's song. It's 11 o'clock.
92 to 95 FM.
And 1341 medium wave.
BBC Radio Ulster.
And at 11 o'clock, this is the news with Linda Ray. A woman whose home was shot at in Antrim last night says she'll be moving out of the house as soon as possible. Deborah Gregg was preparing to take her dog for a walk shortly after midnight when two shots were fired from a shotgun through the front door at Renown Court. Her 14-year-old son Jonathan was showered with splinters of wood. He and his mother weren't hurt but suffered shock. Ms. Gregg says she doesn't know why they were attacked but plans to move out as soon as they can be rehoused. Pro-agreement politicians are at Hillsborough Castle for the second meeting of the group which monitors the Good Friday Agreement. The meeting is being chaired by the Secretary of State, John Reid, and the Irish Foreign Minister, Brian Cowan. Our political editor, Mark Devonport, is at Hillsborough.
The politicians arrived at Hillsborough Castle making clear their own very different priorities. The SDLP leader, Mark Durkin, says the institutions set up under the Good Friday Agreement mustn't be held hostage as a result of either paramilitary wrongdoing or party political posturing. Sinn Féin's Gerry Adams believes the most important issue is the deteriorating situation in Belfast's interface areas. With Tony Blair and Bertie Ahern due over for more negotiations next week, expectations of today's meeting appear to be low. The Ulster Unionist leader David Trimble isn't attending the talks, leaving his party to be represented by the Environment Minister Dermot Nesbitt. The Alliance leader David Ford said Mr Trimble's absence raised questions about his level of commitment to the implementation group.
Members of Derry City Council say they're seriously concerned about the state of the ambulance service in the city. They say the lack of adequate cover and the condition of some of the vehicles is placing a heavy strain on crews. The council's asking for an urgent meeting with senior ambulance service management to discuss the problem. The Palestinian leadership has announced that presidential and parliamentary elections are to be held early next year. Officials have also set out a timetable for reforms of Palestinian institutions. But they say the changes are in response to Palestinian needs, not to demands made by President Bush. From Jerusalem, Claire Marshall reports.
The formal announcement of elections was made in Jericho, the only major Palestinian city not under Israeli control. Speaking at a news conference, Palestinian Cabinet Minister Saeb Erekat said that legislative elections will be held in early January and, for the first time, local elections will be held in March. He also announced a programme of intensive reform of the Palestinian Authority, including the establishment of an independent judiciary. However, Mr. Erekat criticised the current Israeli operation in the West Bank. He said that it would be impossible for elections to be held while Israeli tanks are on the streets of Palestinian cities and while over a half a million Palestinian people are under military curfew.
A letter by the Prince of Wales complaining over relentless questioning about life as a royal is to be auctioned. The letter from Prince Charles was sent in 1981 when he was on tour in New Zealand. In it, he says he would go demented if one more child asked him what it was like to be a prince.
BBC Radio Ulster.
Travel news.
Starting at the city airport, the 20-to-1 flight from Newcastle, that's with British European, has been delayed. It's now expected at around 1:15. On the roads, and the A25 Strangford Road in Downpatrick is closed from 9 in the morning until 5 o'clock. Resurfacing works taking place and diversions are operating until Friday. And finally, the Hillside Road in the Upperlands area is closed as insulation work's been carried out. Again, diversions are in place. Deirdre Horshaw with the Travel News.
The weather becoming brighter this afternoon with a maximum of 16 Celsius. BBC Radio Ulster News.
Thanks. Just after 4 minutes past 11 o'clock, Gerry Anderson here. I'll be here until 12 o'clock. The number again, I tire repeating this, 08459 555 678, or indeed an email, gerry.anderson@bbc.co.uk. I have to say hello. John Martin sends me an email. I have to lean over and read this. He said, say hello from Farah Newton Abbey. Please say hello to my mother, Nancy Martin, who is 89, and my daughter, Laura, who's leaving Kings Park Primary School today. There we go. And there's another. Sorry, I'm having a little trouble with the machine here. Did you ever hear Dickie Henderson?
No, do you want to ring Eileen? Yes, turn me off. He's got. I can't give you this phone number now because he's got the microphone, and I can't give you out this number. You see, you turn this microphone
all
off.
All right then.
Step inside, love. Let me find you a place where the cares of the day will be carried away by the smile on your face. We are together now and forever. Come my way. Step inside, love, and stay. Step inside, love. Step inside, love. Step inside, love. I want you to stay.
Step inside, love.
You look tired, love.
Yeah, you look tired.
Let me turn down the light. Coming out of the cold, rest your head on my shoulder. Love me tonight. I'll always be there if you should need me. Night and day. Step inside, love. And stay. Step inside, love. Step inside, love. Step inside, love. I want you to stay. When you leave me, say you'll see me again. For I'll know in my heart we will not be apart, and I'll miss you till then. We'll be together now and forever. Come my way. Step inside, love.
Step inside love.
I want you to stay.
Yeah. Hit it.
When tears are in your eyes, I'll dry them all. I'm on your side. Oh, when times get rough and friends just can't be found, like a bridge over troubled water, I will lay me down. Like a bridge over troubled water, I will lay me down. When you're down and out, when you're on the street, when evening falls so hard, I will comfort you. I will take your part. Oh, when darkness comes and pain is all around, like a bridge over troubled water, I will lay me down. Like a bridge over troubled water, I will lay me down. I will lay me down.
That's two examples of the latest in our current series of songs we all love, sung by the wrong people. You have no idea who that was.
I haven't. I didn't really hear it because I was speaking to a lady who was telling me about you dancing. So how, right. I couldn't.
What do you mean? What do you mean to a lady telling about me dancing?
I couldn't really hear who it was.
I'll give me the start.
Give me a wee. Give me a second. Identify. Right.
When you're weary,
feeling small.
Feeling small.
right, no problem.
When tears are in your eyes.
Right.
I'll dry them all.
I don't know. Shouldn't know, shouldn't I?
You'd never guess who that was.
No.
Anyway, I have to tell you who that was and the record before that.
Right.
It was Step Inside, love song by Dickie Henderson.
The first one?
Okay. Yeah.
Great. But who was that there?
Bye.
Many people may not have no idea who this is. Well, he was a very famous man a number of years ago. Do you remember the Watergate hearings? Do you remember when President Nixon was impeached? Right. Do you remember the head of the Watergate hearings, Senator Sam J. Irvin Jr.? Used to talk like that. Senator, when was the first time you heard that there was an existence of these tapes in the basement? Yeah. And tell me, Senator, can you verify what the men just done? No, I can't. That was him. It was a bridge over troubled water.
So he's a senator?
Yeah, he's a senator. Senator. He's dead now. God rest him. But somebody talked him into doing that record.
And it's good.
Over troubled water. The word water is pronounced very strangely. You hear, there was a lot of talk this morning.
No, I couldn't hear it.
There was a lot of talk this morning on the radio about shortage of water. I think it's up in the northwest or maybe all over Northern Ireland. And Peter Robinson was on talking about water. He's the environment minister, isn't he?
Mm-hmm. I don't know.
But do you know how he pronounces water?
No.
Water.
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 Water. Water. He'd be very angry. Water.
He's very angry.
He would say
talking
water.
Would he
say water?
How angry would he be?
He would say water. There's a shortage of water. He snaps them all. Snaps the word.
There's a shortage of water.
Yeah, water.
Water is getting very short. And it's Catholics are doing it.
That's you, sacked. Then what about you dancing with the girl?
What's this?
You dance with the girl on the stage.
I danced with
a young violinist?
Yeah, classical violinist, yeah.
Yeah, so I believe. Yeah. The lady was impressed by your movements.
She liked me, classical violinist.
Did she?
Yeah, she
did. Well, was this a rehearsed dance? Was it a Ginger Rogers stare thing?
No, don't you call me Ginger Rogers. No, it was a spontaneous outpouring of compassion.
Well, how do you dance with a violinist? Was she playing the violin at the time?
No, she wasn't, because that's awkward, as you well
that's
know.
That's what I thought.
It can get stuck in your chest. Mm. No, what actually happened was, during the encore of the entire band, they played orchestra.
Band.
They played a rousing tune at the end, and Catherine and I were standing at the side of the stage, and we just felt the need to hold each other. It's simple as that. You wouldn't understand that, of course, spontaneous combustion. You wouldn't understand that. You know, the flame between two people, when the flame gets lighted.
Yes.
You just have to grab them and hold them and dance, and live, sing, dance, and...
There's a man and one.
I'm married, of course. But it's only on the stage.
It's a man on one.
I know there is. It's only
Barnbrecker appearing in the Opera House.
Cemetery?
Oh, no, the Opera House on the 8th, the 9th and 10th of August.
Barnbrack.
Yes.
Apropos, an inquiry which came from a person who is here from Canada or America and who is deeply... very keen to get to hear. I can't talk today.
You're right, that's all right.
Very keen to get to hear Barnbrack. I didn't know where they were playing. I said they were probably all dead.
Mm-hmm.
But they're not. They're playing on the 8th, 9th, 10th of October.
No, August.
August by thunder. Where are they playing?
The Opera House.
The Opera House? Really?
Yeah, three nights in the Opera House.
Must be able to get nobody else. Everybody else must be on holidays. Are they on with somebody? They're on their own?
I don't know.
Is that not Mae McFetridge's thing?
I don't know. I know nothing about it.
Ah, where is this person?
The person's on one.
Yeah, okay. Hello, good morning.
Hello, Geraldo.
Good morning.
How's she cutting?
Geraldo? No, that's all right. I accept that. Because she's cutting grand.
Is she? How's your water?
My water is flowing normally. That's Willie Crowe. Willie, I haven't heard from you from a long time. It takes something special to rouse you. What seems to be the trouble?
Oh, I just rang up for a yarn.
No, you didn't.
I haven't been listening to you for a long time.
Well, where have you been?
I've been away.
Where have you been?
I was inside.
Where have you been? Incarcerated?
Incarcerated.
The maze? No, there's nobody in there now but refugees. Where were you?
Oh, no, I was away just...
Ach, will you tell me something? Where were you?
I wasn't anywhere. I was busy working.
You were nowhere?
I'm off now for a week.
In other words, you were unable to listen to the radio.
Yes, that's quite correct.
Why didn't you say it in the first place?
I haven't got the grasp of grammar that you have, you see.
Don't be saying to people that you're away when you're not away, because people will ask you where you were and then you won't tell them because you weren't
that's
away.
That's right.
Because you were nowhere. So don't lie to me. No, you always have a reason to ring. There's something annoying you.
That's right.
Right.
Two things are annoying me.
How did I know that? Right, go ahead.
Which one do you want first?
The first one.
I want to give out about the MOT centre.
About the fella not changing his number plates, even though he had them sitting in the back seat.
That's right.
Do you think Mr. Coyle was on the side of the examiner?
That's right.
Was he right?
No.
Well, he always goes for the authority, the institutions. Now, what do you think?
Well, tell me this. Do you go into the MOT centre?
Only when I'm summoned.
Or have you got a new car?
I have never had a new car. I have never had a new car in my life.
Do you like going in there?
I don't like going in there, no.
Oh,
because there's always a
when that door starts to slide across, it's like an undie prison.
It's like of course we know what that's like. It's like going into Hades. You well know it's another word for hell. In case
that's right.
No, I don't mind going in there, but there's always that ever-present possibility of rejection, which I can't handle.
That's right.
I've been rejected there a number of times.
It's about 100 times worse than doing the 11 plus.
I know the man might say your flange isn't up to scratch.
Well, Al, do you want to hear my wee experience?
Oh, I'd love to.
Well, I have an old 30-year-old car.
30?
30 years old.
It's not a vintage car, it's just an old car.
Well, it's an old Money Cooper.
Okay. I
have to go down there every year, down to new buildings.
New buildings?
Mm.
Well, they say water.
Water?
Yes.
And my knees be knocking, as they say.
Uh-huh.
So the door slides across.
Mm-hmm.
Now, my car is temperamental.
Yeah.
And sometimes when you switch it off, it won't start.
It looks bad when you can't start your car to go into the MOT centre.
But it's just a wee simple thing.
Uh-huh.
So I went down, you see, and I said, I know what I'll do. I'll keep the car running.
Uh-huh.
So the door started to slide across, and then I went.
Uh-huh.
And the first thing he says, could you switch your car off, sir? No, they sound like a policeman.
Yeah, they are. They want to be policemen.
No, they were
policemen.
They were thrown out for being too cruel.
Stop. Stop this. And then they put them in the MOT centre.
That's right.
Okay.
So I said, I'm going to switch it off, it mightn't start again.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, he says, you have to switch it off. I says, well then, the chances of this happening's million to one. So I switched it off and I tried the headlights and the indicators. He says, that's okay, sir, could you drive down now to the pit? I always think they're going to throw me in there.
Yeah, the pit, yeah.
So I turned the key and I went,
You went like that, or the car went like
the
that?
The car.
Oh, sorry, I thought that was you there for a moment.
And I started giving out a grunt. Ah, hold on. And I went,
That car sounds almost human.
It does.
Yeah.
So I thought, this is terrible. So I looked in the mirror and your mum went round the back.
Uh-huh.
And he shouted over to his, hey, who are there? Here. And next thing, there were three of them at the back of the car.
Giving her a push?
Giving her a push.
Oh, well, that's nice of them.
And I said to myself, well, you see what they say about all these boys? It's not true at all. They're dead on. They are human.
Well, that's okay.
So they started pushing me down through the MOT centre. And you know the big door at the back? It doesn't go across. It goes up.
It goes up, yes.
It started to slide up.
Uh-huh.
And they pushed me out through the door.
Uh-huh. And did you pass?
No, they pushed me out through the door.
Oh, straight out?
Straight out.
Oh, they never even stopped and looked at you?
They weren't giving me a push to get me started.
They're just getting rid of you?
They were pushed me out through the door.
And what did they say to you then? They give you a wee thing saying, we're sorry, they give you a little thing, a wee failure slip.
When they pushed me out through the door, I turned the key and I started. Uh-huh. So walking back in, and the door at this stage was down there about 2 feet. It was like one of those limbo dancers trying to get back in.
So you went for it, did you?
I says, it's going. Oh, I says, that's no good. He says, you're too late.
Too late because the door had already closed.
I was outside. I wasn't going to get back in again.
So in other words, this is quite complicated and maybe a mystery to many of the people who are not aware of the vagaries of the MOT system. Let me just explain to people. You park outside and there's a line there.
That's right.
And there's a big sign that says, you park there, don't move. And then the gate goes...
That's right. Very good.
That's the gate, isn't it?
That's the gate.
And then you go in there.
And you go.
And they examine all about you.
They do your lights and your indicators and all that carry on.
And then you go, it's an assembly line, and you go along there and then a man writes something.
You go onto the pit and he gets in underneath and starts poking.
That's right, yeah. So in other words, they didn't give you a chance to get poked at all.
I wasn't poked, I was just pushed straight out through the door.
They seem to treat you with some, well, shabbily, I think is the word. Yeah, you were treated shabbily.
Hmm.
And did you have another appointment then?
Oh, I had to pay up more though and then get another appointment.
Another 16 quid or so, isn't it?
That's right.
Maybe more than that. Well, I think that's shameful behaviour. And they wouldn't accept any kind of explanation from you.
No.
You tried to explain the situation?
That's right.
They wouldn't.
I said, this is a 30-year-old car, you know, I wonder what the new Ford Focus will be like in 30 years' time. Will it go on through and pass?
They didn't care about that.
Oh, not at all.
All right, then. You've registered your complaint on that. What's the second thing?
I want to give out about Seamus Heaney.
The poet laureate?
Mm.
The Nobel Prize winning poet? Yes, what about him?
He told me to stop playing my flute.
When did he do that?
Oh, it's a while ago there. I was down in, you know, that restaurant there down near Bridge End? Is it Greenan?
Greenan of Island? It used to be an old church?
That's it.
Yes, nice place it is too.
That's
yes.
Beautiful.
Yes.
Well, there was a, what would you call it? What would you call a collection of poets?
A gaggle of poets?
I remember we're on air.
A bore of poets?
A clatter.
A clatter, yeah, okay.
What about, I have a good one, a puke of poets.
A puke of poets, yeah, aye. Okay, yeah.
And I was there playing my flute, and there was a girl with a harp.
Yes.
And she was playing the harp, and I was playing the flute, and the next thing the waiter came down, and he said, excuse me, Mr. Heaney, I want you to stop playing your flute.
Well, were you employed there gainfully?
Yes.
And you were there to play for...
I was entertaining.
You were there to play for Mr. Heaney and the Puka Poets?
And the Puka Poets, aye.
And they said to stop.
He well, came down, he said, I want to hear the harp on his own.
That's not very encouraging for
no.
you.
No. Well, now, you see, he's probably given the waiter the message, and then the waiter come down and give me the message, and maybe the message was slightly different, you know, as they say, the message was different in the translations.
Well, he has some cheek on him, Seamus Heaney. Next time I see him, I'll tear a strip off him.
And I was going to go up and give him a mouthful, I'll tell you. And say, there you are, Mr. Heaney, translate that.
And, soliloquy that. You, the dead image of Mr. Galway and everything.
But it didn't sound like him, maybe that's what was wrong.
But you see, you have to face the fact that you're not great, you know.
No.
And you see, Mr. Heaney may indeed have recognised this right away.
Is that what it is?
Could have well been that, you know, he preferred to hear the harp alone because maybe the harp was quite good.
Oh, he's very fond of the harp. He was at a big do in London afterwards and he made a wee... You know, he got very poetic when he was saying a few words. Do you remember he was at a thing one time in Bianca Jagger or something was at it?
That's right, yeah.
And he was on about the heather on the mountain and the salmon on the river and the deer in the glen.
I know, I can't be bothered with that.
And the
stuff.
Sound of the harp, he said.
The sound of the harp.
I wish I'd been sitting there. I said, what about the old flute?
He might have said, one of the things that intrigues me about the Ulster countryside is the call of the snipe, the sound of the harp, but not the sound of Willie Crow's flute. He may say that the next time.
He might.
Well, those are two very embarrassing
incidents. That was very hurtful now.
It's a wonder you haven't got your head in the gas oven.
Well, I haven't played it much since.
There you are, been wheeled out of the MOT centre in ignominy and then insulted in public by a Nobel Prize winner. That's fairly hard to beat, you know.
Well, I suppose another way you could be insulted in the street. That was a very sort of insulted at a very high level.
You've been insulted higher than anyone else I know. Well, Willie, no wonder you have felt the need to ring to get this off. Oh,
but these boys are all up in the air. No, your man, they were talking about going to... one of them says, I think I have to go to the toilet. Mm-hmm. And the other boy says, hold on. Oh, maybe I will. And then, to pee or not to pee. You know all this. They were very sort of poetic.
Well, you see, I have to be honest with you now, and I may have said this before, Mr. Crow, but I can't take poets as a rule. I have to be honest with you. I remember one particular program, and you see, I think they're bluffers. I think they're bluffers. I really do.
I know.
Because, what?
Are you low again? Have you got low again?
Look, you're starting again. I'm not low again. I can't get lower.
No, you see, you're leaning back in your chair, and you're leaning right away back from your mic.
I lean forward.
Yes. Business. Anyway, you see, I think they're bluffers because, you know, when I look at some of the poetry, and, you know, I really... You say to yourself, it's like kind of abstract painting. You know, ride the bicycle across the canvas and throw out a jug of paint and that'll do rightly.
That's right.
But it was kind of proved to me one time. I remember years ago I saw this programme about poets. It was Van Morrison was involved in it. And Van is not, you know, well, let's just say that Van had written a song and there was one very prominent poet. I'm not going to name him because it would be quite rude. And Van was sitting there and he was asking this prominent poet to recite some of his work. So the prominent poet recited some of his work and I said to myself, what a load of crap. And then the prominent poet said to Van, let's hear some of your work. And Van sort of went something like, I went out on a Saturday night looking for a fight, then come this bird and I hit her third. You know, that kind of thing. And the poet said, That's very revealing, Van, and very... That's beautiful. And I went to myself, what a tosser, I thought to myself. He's just saying that to Van because Van's Van who he is, like.
Van's
and there were just
Van.
Two of them were bluffing each other. And I said to myself, to hell with that for a game of cowboys. So I don't have a lot of time for... But the only... This may sound strange. I only have time for... I like people like John Campbell, people who sit down and tell you a real story, and they actually make it rhyme. You know, a clever rhyme. And I know people out there, experts, are saying, oh, it's not the rhyme that's important. But I like that. I like that. I don't like this kind of poems passing as prose and no rhymes, no air or smell. I don't like that. It means nothing. Anyway, here's my pen. I'll dig with it. That's me finished now. You still there?
I'm still here.
Well, thank you.
I'm listening intently.
Thank you, William, for joining us today. And it's not every day a man is insulted by the government and a Nobel Prize winner. Okay. Long may you flourish and come back again when you're insulted again.
Right.
Okay.
That won't be too long, I think.
And don't give up your flute because, after all, nobody likes you playing it.
Is okay. That the word in the street?
That's the word in the street. Apparently so.
No good.
No good at all.
Oh, that's...
I'll have a word with Mr. Galway. I believe he's in Bern at the moment in Switzerland.
That's right.
Okay, then. I'll tell him you said hello.
Have a nice day.
I tell him it's Seamus Heaney asked you to stop playing your flute. He'd be very upset. Okay. Bye, Willie.
Have a nice day.
Have a nice day.
Miss you already.
Love you, miss you, mean it.
That's it.
Bye. Bye.
What? There's a man looking a generator.
Doc, tell him to catch himself.
Oh, he's a senior citizen.
Oh, is he? Hello, good morning. I believe you're looking for a generator.
Yeah, I wouldn't bother you, but I'll tell you my plight.
Okay.
I'm living in a condemned house. Well, waiting for a replacement dwelling.
It's not a great start, then.
Which will take some 6 or 7 months, providing they can find the builder that will do it for the money. But in the meantime, I suffer from chronic chest disease.
Well, what are you doing living in a condemned house if you've got chest disease?
Well, I've got nowhere else to live. And the thing is, they're going to put up a new bungalow for me.
Oh, well, is that the social services people, housing executive?
No, that's the housing executive. Providing I can find the builder to do it for the money.
Right.
In the meantime, I'm sitting here this last 2 months without light nor heat. And I've got to use a wee machine during the day and during the night. It's called a nebulizer.
A nebulizer, of course.
And it requires electricity. Yeah. And I can't use it because of lack of it. No electricity.
You can't use your nebulizer because you have no electricity.
Which makes breathing very difficult, and my chest then is suffering. And it's the downhill.
Well, do you have a social worker?
I do.
Well, what's wrong with them? Can they not sort you out?
No.
Why not?
And Social Security don't want to know.
No, but the Social Security, it's a social worker's job to make sure that you get electricity for your nebulizer.
No, they say... They can't help.
They can't help you? What are they for if they're not?
Well, you asked me. If I were a dog and was put in a boarding kennel, the law requires 60 degrees of heat for a dog.
I know.
Night or day.
That's right.
But there's nothing regarding people.
Well, I find that very... Well, as a matter of fact, I don't find it all that surprising, to be honest with you. Because I used to work in the social services too, and I know that sometimes, you know, it's not the best, to be honest with you.
Well, I tell you what it was. I bought a brand new generator Christmas.
Uh-huh.
Spent all my money on it. And it's going kaput. And the manufacturer says, because of the hours is up on it, that's it. The guarantee's out.
Too many miles up on her.
Now...
No, go on.
The thing is, I went to Social Security to see about a grant.
Yes.
And they say, no, a grant would add to the value of your property. If you bought a generator, it would add to the value of your property, and that we can't cater for that.
Well, that sounds...
I said, no, it is to keep body and soul together and maintain health. They said, no, we haven't got anything written down here that says that.
Well,
I spoke to a travelling man, and he tells me that their people can get upwards of £2,000 for to go and buy a generator for those same reasons, to maintain your health. But when I put this to Social Security, they said they never heard of it. So I'm caught. Oh, I'm not asking for nothing for nothing. If a buddy had a generator laying out the back there not been used, I got pay him, you know, I got pay him a reasonable sum of money, you know.
That's funny.
It wouldn't be anywhere near like the price of a new one, you know.
Okay, well, I find that very sad, actually. You know, your social worker should be doing this. You shouldn't be going to the Social Security, you know, looking for stuff like that. They should be doing that for you. Because I used to do that kind of work, as I said before, and that's not... I mean, you're a man who's obviously not all that well.
To say the least, and my wife's health did start to deteriorate. In fact, her mental health is, because if you can imagine this day and age, his last 2 months, if it weren't for a few friends that we have taking bags of washing and relieving her strain there, you know.
I think that's disgraceful.
But, like, you're sitting here from 9 o'clock at night in the dark and trying to do your best, you know.
That's no good at all. Where do you live? Do you live in an isolated area, or do you live somewhere?
I live 2.5 miles above Carrickfergus.
Yeah, right.
It's not in the wilds of Afghanistan, you know.
No, it's not exactly Bangladesh, you know.
No, but over 7 generators out to Afghanistan because of the same reason.
All right then, okay. Well, I think do we have somebody there?
Yeah, Jernan got a call there. Someone's going to lend them a generator.
Is a man going to lend you a generator?
Oh, God, bless him.
Mm-hmm. So Hold on a minute. Do we have any details on that?
Yeah, we'll get in contact with the man when you finish, yeah.
Well, there's a man willing to lend you one now for a start.
Oh, God bless him.
I'm sure we'll get other offers, but we'll hear as the programme goes on, and we'll contact you.
God bless you.
And we'll put you on. But that's a shame. I think that's disgraceful. Do you have any, without being a very personal, you don't have to ask this in any, answer this in any kind of detail, but do you have, I mean, are you well off in any way?
Not at all, no.
Well, you see, that would be the only reason why they wouldn't help you. If you had a rake of money of your own.
No, but I work for a living.
I know, but well, sometimes that strikes against you. But you know, you haven't got a load of savings.
99.9% against you.
The people who work actually are treated the more shabbily, as far as I can see. But you don't have a whole lot of you don't have independent means.
None whatsoever.
Well, they should be helping you. They should be sorting all that out. And you know.
In fact, I'm still paying off the other generator on a credit card.
You're not serious.
I am.
Well, I don't know the whole story, and I don't want to be quick to judge, but it looks as if you're being very badly treated. And okay, well, listen, we'll figure out who's going to lend you a generator or give you a generator. Here, there's a man going to give you one now.
There's a man now. The phones are, there's a great response. And there's a gentleman, I've got a phone number. He doesn't want his name given out. He doesn't want any publicity, but he said that he will give him a generator.
There you are. You've
got a phone number here.
You've got a generator for free.
I'll pass that on. Thanks,
God bless you.
Okay, we'll pass you all the information. And do you mind if we give that gentleman your phone number?
Not at all.
Okay, then.
God bless you.
Let us know how you get on, okay?
Thank you very much indeed.
Okay, bye.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
Yeah. The result of your survey, by the way, is next.
Better play some music first.
Well, he's waiting for you.
No, I want to prepare myself for this.
Are you sure? This is the Daniel O'Donnell survey.
I know exactly what it is.
Do you?
Yeah.
What was it?
Can't remember now.
No, I know. I knew you were bluffing.
Where is he?
He's on one.
James Morton.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Morning, James.
Jerry, I'm going to put you up for an award.
What's that for?
Because you're the best man in the province to help everybody.
Well, you see, this is why we're here.
And you absolutely astound me at times, the work that you can get through.
I know. I'm very suspicious when I hear any kind of praise from you. It means that there's something else coming worse behind.
Tell me, did the lady get her passports on Friday?
Let me just check. Yeah. Sean, what was
we
the story?
We never heard from her.
No, I don't think she bothered about us.
I think that was a wind-up.
You see, I'll tell you about that. To be honest with you, it struck me as quite odd, because if that had happened to me, I would have turned around and went home and got it.
Hey, or you would phone home and say, well, someone's up in
get
the
it up to me.
Get it up to me.
Get it up to me. Yeah. And but that always... That struck me as odd, so I didn't worry too much about that.
A lady phoned to say that you lowered the tone of Saturday night's concert.
I did not.
That's what she said.
Well,
she said to walk on the stage. Would you hear this, James?
Right.
Do you know what, you know, he didn't wear a...
Did he saunter on?
He didn't wear a nice... Well, you wore a nice suit, but you didn't wear an evening suit or a dress suit.
I wore a dress suit.
You did not. The lady says you did not.
She's a liar. I had a dress suit on and a tabby bow and...
Did you wear a buttonhole?
Was it a black suit?
Yes. It's a black dinner jacket and a black dinner suit.
Had you a buttonhole?
No.
What had you got in your breast pocket?
Okay.
Well, I got me nothing.
She said you had a row of fountain pens.
I had not. That was me glasses case.
Well, you could put your glasses case in your dinner jacket.
What is she? SAS?
And she said you went out, and before the band, as you call them, played Carmen, you explained them what Carmen was all about, as if they didn't know.
A lot of people there didn't know.
And when the band finished playing Carmen, you explained to him again what that was just all about.
That's because a lot of them didn't know. She sounds like an old smart arse to me.
And she said, you do not ever remove your bow tie on stage.
I did not do that.
You did just.
I did not.
You did. So she said.
You tell her to get a life.
And
okay.
She said, you grabbed the wee violinist by the arm and you swished her around.
I know I did that, yeah.
She said, but it wasn't.
You must have been too eager, Jay.
To tell her to go and have a pint of stout or somewhere and a hamburger and go to Mallorca for a week, she'll be all right. Okay, well, listen, I don't have... What's he talking? Who's this? James, what seems to be the trouble, James?
Tell me this, Jay. Did they play the arrival of the Queen of Sheba Saturday night?
They didn't, no. No, that's... No.
Would you play that sometime?
I like that, yeah.
I like it too.
Uh-huh. Tell me... Never mind that crap. Tell me about the results of your survey.
You asked me to find out should the public think that I should be in this club.
What club?
The Daniel Club.
Oh, yes, sorry. Right, let me just
You're
explain.
Not butthurt at all.
Let me Mr. Coyle.
What it was all about at all, Jerry was talking.
Let me just explain. I don't have a piece of paper here, but there's Daniel O'Donnell is doing a new TV series, right? And there's going to be 11 shows. And they're going to be recorded between the 29th of August and the 3rd of September. They're going to do two or three a day. Right. What do people want? What Daniel wants? He wants an audience. He wants the same audience every night. And he wants an audience made up of people who've got a story to tell, who are a bit of crack, who he can talk to, and who will feed back from him and interact with him. And if anybody wants to get involved in that, they may do so, and I'll give you the details later. And you wanted to know, was there any reason at all why you shouldn't be in that audience? I could.
No, you told me to go and find out.
No, but I can think of a number of reasons why you shouldn't be in it. But you wouldn't believe me. You wouldn't accept it from me. So you decided to go and find out.
You asked me to go.
Yes, I asked you to go. Don't split hairs. So, yeah, I asked you to go. And so what was the results? Let me just check. Mr. Coyle.
Yes?
Okay. Go on. Sorry, I have to ask him something. Go ahead.
Go ahead.
Yes. Ask what do you mean, go ahead? Go ahead. You're the one who did the survey.
He said you wanted to ask him. Well, look, Jay, I asked him, should I be allowed in?
Yes.
Right?
Yes.
Now, 25% of the people that I asked said I should not be invited.
Huh?
And 15% said I was too grumpy and unable to display sincerity.
That's what I said to you, and you wouldn't listen.
You didn't say that to me.
Well, that's what I thought.
And 24% of people reckoned that I would have nothing to contribute.
That's what I said to you, too.
Well, you did say that, right enough.
Right.
16% said I was past my sell-by date.
Well, I thought that, but I didn't say it to you.
You said that as well.
Oh, did I? Right. So.
And 20% said they should open the door and let me in. What do you think of that?
I don't know what to think of that. Those are mixed results.
That's an Ed McCartney slogan, open the door and let him in.
Mm-hmm.
You don't like McCartney, see, you don't.
I don't like him, no. No, I don't like any of them, to be honest with you, but I like him.
Less.
Well, no, I can't say that because he might sue me.
Well, now, that's what they said. They should open the door and let me in.
Open the door and let me in. Well, I don't know. I'll tell you what I'll do, James. I wouldn't do this for just anyone. I'm going to have words with the people behind this show, and I'm going to tell them a little about you.
Hey, with Daniel?
Yes.
I met Daniel, you know.
When did you meet him?
During the BBC, when you were there.
When he was with me?
You had an audience with him.
That's right. That's right. Oh, I remember that well.
That's a quite a while ago.
It's a very long time ago. He's only about 15 or 16.
He wasn't that old, that's right.
He had a big fat face.
You were a lot younger then, too.
I was a lot younger, yes. But, you know, we've fallen out. A lot of water has passed under the bridge since then. Daniel and I have fallen out a couple of times, and we've always...
But see, you've made up again.
We always made up again. We're good friends now.
Are you?
Yeah, we are indeed. We are indeed, yes. I'm actually going to be working with him on this program.
Are you?
Yes.
What are they bringing you on for?
Well, don't sound so surprised. I have a number of functions there. Daniel wants me to be with him.
See, you're getting your finger in a wee pie.
I wouldn't have put
you
it...
You must have watched something.
I wouldn't have put it like that myself. Hold on a second. Are you still... Are you
thank
the phone?
You. Thank you. Bye-bye.
Listen.
Bye.
I don't have that piece of paper with that information on it.
Yes, you do. I gave it to you.
I haven't got it.
I gave it to you.
I haven't got it.
Have you got a pen?
It's a big piece of paper.
It's a big piece of paper, but I haven't got
it. Have you got a pen?
Will you get that?
Have you got the numbers? Have you got the numbers?
I have nothing.
There? Oh, hold on. We get the numbers.
Bring
the numbers
them in here.
Well, listen, they're advertising on the TV.
Pardon? Yeah. What?
They're advertising on the TV.
I know they are.
It comes up every so often.
It comes up. That's like myself. Right.
You're always coming up.
I've got these numbers now. Give me that, will you? Sorry.
Give him a pen. Give him a pen.
Let me just say to the people before we continue our conversation, anyone who would like to have a go at being in Daniel's audience. Now, this is about 11 shows, and you have to be available.
For every one of them?
Yes. The 29th of August and the 3rd of September. I mean, you take a week's holiday if you're a real fan.
Oh, I'm going off soon, Jack.
Well, I heard that. No, but you see, there's no reason at all why you shouldn't be considered, and I'm going to talk to the people about you.
But I'm not a good storyteller, Jack.
No, but at least you can give out to people. You're good at that. Now, let me just say that anyone who wants to get involved in this, and it's kind of an interaction thing. They'll be in the audience, and Daniel will be turning around saying, what will Daniel be saying?
I'll go and check.
A lot of banter.
No.
A lot of banter, like, back and forward.
Yes, we'll recreate the show now in a moment. Sean, for the benefit of the listeners, we're going to recreate what might happen during Daniel's show. Right.
What?
We're going to recreate what might happen during Daniel's show. Right. You're Daniel, okay?
Right.
You're sitting there and you're interviewing, say, Dolly Parton.
Hello, Dolly. How are you doing, Dolly? God, it's great to have you on the show and thanks very much. That song was lovely. Ladies and gentlemen, will you give a big round of applause, please, now, to Dolly Parton?
Now, this is where I come in. I'm in the audience, say.
Mm-hmm.
And I go, hold on a minute!
Oh, who's that? Who's that shouting? Oh, I might have known it was Blatterhead.
It's me in seat 25F.
Right, hold on till I get up there now. And I'm just...
No, you sit with your son.
I'm climbing up through the audience now to see you.
No, you have to sit with your...
Wait, where am I?
You're sitting just...
Sure, you get up with a mic.
Sure, I'll get up with the mic, as James
No, I have the old mic.
I want to walk through the people.
You're not going to walk through the people. Will you stop messing this about? You're sitting talking to Dolly Parton. I'm in the audience. And you're saying...
Dolly, I'm sorry about that. That's a fella. He's got his own radio show on Radio Ulster. His name's Gerry Anderson, and he's just an old torture, an old sticking plaster. What do you want?
I want you to ask her the questions you haven't asked her all night.
What question do you want me to ask Dolly Parton?
Ask her what size her chest is.
It's big. It's good enough for me.
You see, that's the sort of thing that'll go on there.
Is that what needs to go on?
That'll go on. That kind of thing will go
right,
on.
Right, great.
And I can see you doing that.
Right.
I can see you doing that.
And I can say I bumped into you one day.
You can say we are friends. Right, all the people
you
have
bumped
to...
bumped under once.
Yes.
We're finished doing Daniel now.
Oh, sorry.
That was a long time ago.
I had something to say there.
Well, what? Go on.
No,
go back.
It's too late.
Go back with Daniel again.
The moment's gone. Now the moment's
gone. Go on.
But you must be initiative.
No, what sort of stories would James tell? James must have some story out and about that
James
saw me woman's book.
So James is on the knocker.
I know.
Anyone who's on the knocker has stories to tell.
I have a couple of death stories to tell you.
Death stories?
Uh-huh.
What? Well, you know what I'm going to tell you? James, funny you should say that.
This got to do with policies.
No, I found... I never told you this, Mr. Coyle, and I...
You found a policy?
No, I found a dead man one time.
You did not?
I did.
See?
I did. Well,
where?
I won't tell you where in respect to his relatives, but, you know, when I was working, you call around... When I was on the knocker, so to speak, you call around to people's houses.
Make sure they're okay.
Yeah. And one time, this is true. No, I'm not joking here. Yeah. I called around one time and I knocked on this man's door and he didn't answer the door.
Dear.
And I went next door and I said, is Mr. So-and-so, is he out? And he said, no, he's in there. I saw him there about half an hour ago. I said, he's not answering his door. So the person next door had a wee key. You know, sometimes you give neighbours a key and kiss it. She said, well, I'll just go in. And it was a girl. And I got a bad feeling. And I said, let me go in first. And I went to the living room door. It was closed. And I went to open it, and there was something blocking the door from opening.
Oh, dear, dear.
The man was lying dead. Yeah. That's true.
And were you frightened, Jai?
I wasn't.
Did you get a scare?
I did get a terrible scare, yeah. I've never seen anything like that before. It was awful. Has something ever happened to you? Have you that happened to you?
But that's not the sort of stories we want.
No.
We don't want stories like that.
Daniel,
don't
no,
we want. We yeah. want a bit of comedy.
No, Daniel.
Well,
that would bring the whole thing
the
down.
The everyday occurrence of a man on the knocker.
I mean, you must have seen some things when you were on your knocker.
I've seen a few.
Well, tell us a story now. What's the worst thing ever happened to you?
The worst thing ever happened?
Do women ever answer the door wearing little clothing?
Oh, that happened regular, Jay.
Have you ever succumbed?
Oh, no, Jay. No, I'm a one-girl guy.
Well, do they ever make advances towards you?
No, but it happened before. At one time, I was a bread server. I got propositioned.
Tell me what happened. Go on.
Oh, I couldn't tell you.
I don't need any detail. No, I like this kind of stuff.
I used to go to. I used to go to a wee bakery shop over in the Craigie Road, Woodstock Road, Craigie Road. I'm not sure which.
Uh-huh.
And there was a nice young lady used to serve, and I used to put bread on the shop.
Did you give her a lodger's loaf?
Oh, yeah, I did. Mm-hmm. And sometimes I'd went a wee bit too far, you know, a wee
like
bit of banter.
Yes, yes.
But I couldn't tell you anything else.
No, you can.
Oh, I can't.
No, okay, you're in the shop.
My wife might be listening.
Right. They're in the shop and there's a wee bit of banter, right? And that's all right. Sometimes it goes just a wee bit.
She probably asked James had he a crusty top.
Or a lodger's loaf, for that matter. And, will I ask him? Do you have a crusty top?
Not now, Jay.
No.
Used to have.
And so what? It moved on from there.
It moved into the back of the shop.
Right. So the two of you went into the back.
Well.
And there was a bit of grappling went on, wasn't it?
I don't mind a bit, Jai, you know.
Well, who initiated the grappling? Was it the lady?
Oh, I couldn't say, Jai.
And I hope you stopped.
Oh, I did. I had to go on my rounds.
Mm-hmm.
I couldn't wait for and say half an hour or so. All the people were waiting for me to call on them.
Half an hour? That was optimistic, wasn't it?
Oh,
yeah, and you had a van full of Paris buns.
And I had to get rid of him.
Mm-hmm, exactly. All right, then. I don't want to push you on that, but...
Oh, no, I couldn't say any more, Jack.
That's the type of thing Daniel wants to hear.
You think so?
Well, maybe not. So anyone who's interested in becoming... anyone who's got any decent stories that don't end up in the back room of a bakery, you can collect a form. You fill in an application form. You can lift one in any BBC Northern Ireland reception broadcasting house, or indeed here at BBC Radio 4, we have some out there.
Right.
Or you can ring the following number. 08-700-100-900.
08-700-100-900.
That's right. Or indeed, if you want to email, the email...
I can't work the email, Jay. I told you that before.
Not talking to you, I'm talking to the audience. Whatever, however small it may be. The email number is night.club@bbc.co.uk. All lowercase. And not, as Mr. Coyle says, in capital letters.
I didn't say in capital letters.
Lowercase.
I wrote that out for you in capital letters so you would see it.
You wrote it down in capital letters.
You told me that before about
it.
Lowercase.
You don't talk in capital letters.
I talk in capital letters. Do you want to hear me talking in capital letters? I'll say your name. Sean! Call! That's how you talk in capital letters.
Tell James how he uses the email again.
Sean, I can't get into this computer
so
business.
No, you see, I explained this to you before. But
Will
I.
You turn me off, please?
I gave you wrong information the last time because I'm on a broad...
Somebody came back and said you did that.
Yes, I did. Because I didn't realise...
You're on a broad band.
I'm on a broad band, whereas you, unfortunately, being a working class chap, you're on a narrow band.
I wouldn't even know that, Jerry.
Yeah, okay. So the email address, night.club at bbc.co.uk. That's lowercase. The number to ring is 08700 100 900, or alternatively, collect an application form at any BBC Northern Ireland reception.
Right, John.
Indeed, scattered around the province, I wouldn't be too surprised to hear. All right, James. Well, I will work. I'll talk to the people and talk to
you. See what you get. Well, whatever you can come up with, Jai.
Okay, you're a possible. And listen,
don't forget the arrival of Queen of Sheba.
And you're free those dates?
Oh, I don't know, but I have to work around it.
29th of August, the 3rd of September, inclusive.
Inclusive.
It's not, it's about a week, you know, 5
And
days.
Would it be during the day?
Oh, yes.
It's not night work.
One after, do you know
Spricks.
That?
What was the name of the man looking for the Spricks?
Oh, I don't know, Sean.
I'll find that out for you. I'll have that information for you tomorrow. I think there might be, I don't know. I'll find that out. That's important. Good question. I'll find that out for you, and I'll have that information for you in the morning, okay?
Right, Jai.
God bless you, my son.
Good luck to you tonight.
Bye.
Take care.
I will.
Bye.
Bye.
There is a spot in old Ireland.
Mother!
and the sweating. Now my dear is at a bitter end. And I will never make the same mistake again, I guarantee my friend.
That's a great song from a little-known group called Wilt, W-I-L-T. It's called It's All Over Now. And before that, the unmistakable tones of Margaret Barry, Queen of the Gypsies. That's from an album called Come Back, Paddy Riley. It's a new release on Emerald. That's on out now at the moment. There's about, what is it, about 11 tracks. Lovely day. Hello, good morning.
Hello, Jerry.
Yes, hello.
Iris from Action Cancer in Ballyclare.
Yes, Iris, how are
you? I was listening to your programme last week and a man rang you about a tape all to do with the murders of the Black Museum.
That's right.
Well, the very next day I was sorting through a box of books. Now, unfortunately, I haven't got the tape, but I came up with a book of murders of the Black Museum.
Oh.
So if this man reads and likes reading, he would probably get a lot more information from the book than the actual tape.
Hmm.
I've put it under the counter, so if he hears me, he can give me a ring. If he's far away from Ballyclare, I will post it to him.
Oh, that's very kind of you.
Right.
Maybe perhaps if he's listening, I don't know if we have the details of that, but if he's listening, give us a ring here, and if he rings, we'll let you know.
Right.
Eh? And if he doesn't ring, we won't.
Right. Well, he might hear me, and he might ring me. It's Ballyclare 324830, if he's listening. And I'll certainly, if he can't get to Ballyclare, I will post it to him.
That's 324830.
Yes.
Ballyclare.
Yes. And could I get a wee quick plug for Action Cancer? The month of June is Action Man Month. I'm sure you've saw the ads on television.
Yes, I have.
And it's about prostate and testicular cancer.
Yes.
So anybody seeing the red boxes, if they get their wee badge and their pine in, it really is for a very, very worthwhile cause.
And those particular two cancers, you know, as far as I know, the early detection rate is quite good if you go for a test.
Exactly. Yeah. Exactly. And the age level is coming down. I don't want to be a scaremonger on the radio, it's good to be aware and to test and to get there immediately. That's what their campaign's all about, aiming for early detection, Jerry.
Yeah. And probably prevention.
Exactly, yeah. Exactly. And cure, undoubtedly cure if it's early detected.
Exactly.
It's just a very worthwhile cause, a cause that's very, very dear to my heart.
Right.
As well as that, I heard you on yesterday and today about charities and the money that was going out to admin and all the rest of it.
Mm.
Could I just make a wee plug for the volunteers that for all these charities, not just Action Cancer, volunteers all over the board with charities, because without them, these charities just wouldn't be up and running. And they don't have maybe money to give, but they give the most valuable commodity in my book, and that is their time.
That's right.
So I just thought I would get a wee plug in for all the girls that are working in my shop at the minute.
No, you're right. I would never castigate any kind of charity.
No. They're all very needy, yeah. And they're all very worthwhile, and of course they need these people. They are businesses, they have to make money, and of course they need the admin side,
yeah.
You know, and they
you can't collect money unless you have good people to make sure that the people give it to you.
Exactly.
Okay.
And as I say, we need to get a plug in for the volunteers, because they give what's to me worth more, and that is their time, and what better thing can any of us give, really?
That's right. All right, love, thanks very much, and
okay.
Thank you for the offer of that book. And if the man wants it, he'll give us a ring and we'll pass on your number.
That's great. And if he can't get to Ballyclare, I'll post it to him, Jerry.
Thank you.
And thank you for listening to me.
Not at all.
Thank you very much indeed.
Bye.
Bye.
Bye. That's us nearly read up here, nearly the end of the programme. There was a King Charles Spaniel lost yesterday in the Falls Road. I hope there's not a question of religious discrimination. I hope they let it go back to its mother and father. We'll be back tomorrow at the same time at 10:30. You can write to us, Gerry Anderson, care of BBC Radio Foyle, Derry Stoke, Londonderry. That'll get me okay. So look after yourselves until then. It is now exactly 11 o'clock, time for the crazies. 92 to 95 FM.